themselves into picking Vans. I don't want to see Origin go for the, oh, we'll take the Jinx away. It's just, I don't think it's a good champion for Aneels. I don't think it fits his play style. I don't think he's very good at the champion as an overall situation. So Origin getting rid of the important picks and picking things they actually want to play for themselves. At least so I was willing to lane on them.
I think there's a case to be made to just get rid of the Morgana, sort of. And by taking it away, if you can play a Fantastic War or just simply ban it out, now you have the freedom on the blue side. You could also just simply see a Jinx ban. Again, no Jinx ban. That Varus, they rated higher, so they must be operating with some information from scrims back in the day. We don't know what these teams know about each other, but
it really feels like Origin prepared a blue side and a red side ban strategy. And unless something very, very rash happened in the games, which they've been able to control these games pretty decently on both sides, they're just sticking exactly with the same bans as they did the last time, which was game 2.
It is a mentality you see, especially on older players and just veterans, where instead of looking at the draft, you keep looking at the game and you get a lot of these what they call what ifs. You know, if we didn't make this mistake, our draft was fine. We just overextended here. If we didn't make this small mistake, but you don't take into account the mistakes the opposing team made. You never go like, oh, if they play this a little, you know, a little worse or a little better, the game could have been entirely different. So, in that regard, Origin could have maybe been wiser to change their ban strategy, but stick with the same thing.
Like, run the first pick, Lulu. Also, just interesting that they're banning away the Varus, even though Marshals haven't shown a propensity to play the champion at all.
And Karsa taking away the Rek'Sai here, or picking the Rek'Sai instead of trying to take away the Elise, I think is better for Flash Fools. We also see continuous pressure being kept up by Karsa on that Rek'Sai. No downtime on that champion. She can always just ulti back into wherever position she wants with the tunnels. And then late game becomes a split pusher to really open up the map. So Flash Fools have been doing a great job utilizing that Rek'Sai pick.
These games have been going so late, and there's such a small amount of action until people are hitting like major item breakpoints. I think instead of a team drafting this incredibly strong early game, rush the game down, win it fast, like, these teams made it to the quarterfinals by playing to their strengths, not by compensating for their weaknesses. So I'd actually expect both of these guys to just pick late game, good map pressure, team compositions and champions. And Origin does steal away the Morgana here, which is the first major variation we see in the draft.
Still, it's the Jinx for Aneels, though, and maybe it'll get a little bit better. NL's already grabbed the Caitlyn, insta-locks it. And the thing is, NL chopped the damage shards of the game on Caitlyn last time around. It's not like this is going to make him not do much damage.
But he used two things to his advantage. One, the initial range advantage to get the first hit. That can get nullified by speeding up Aneels himself, just trading first autos. And secondly, he used Black Shield to be able to stay alive in these aggressive positioning fights. Right now, the Black Shield's on Aneels. And if we go back to some of the games Aneels has played over in Europe, he's shown to be a fantastic player when people run a Jugger X composition, Jugger Killista, Jugger Maw. If you have both the defensive support and a Lua pick, he just plays at the front line, size up skill shots, and he tears the team apart just 1v5. So he can definitely fill that role.
There's also a chance they could throw that Morgana into a solo lane and still pick up Tahm Kench, which would be the absolute absurd protection composition, probably too far on that side, but it's still possible.
Yeah, it'd be hard playing Morgana into Victor and just actually trying to navigate the mid-range team fights there. Just, he belts out so much damage. I do think Morgana has decent mid-lane damage, to be fair to the champion, but yeah, I think it's still very unlikely. Bottom lane and mid-lane matchups shown means Origin will have to choose where this Lulu goes and pick their full lineup.
And now NL will likely not have the potential to freeze a wave that long, because if Amazing picks up the Elise he was looking for earlier to go for that massive chain CC combo, it's incredibly hard for mid laners like Maple to keep clearing that wave and avoid getting dove, because Elise can reset. Worst case, Gragas goes in and gets a wild growth anyways. So if Origin get ahead, they should have learned from their mistake last game and can open up the map more.
Well, I don't think we're going to see Kalista and Jinx in the same team comp, but maybe back to the Anivia here. She actually does a good job of belting out team fight damage just as a champion, high AP builds. And
I mean, look at the peel.
It's tremendous peel. Even without the Tahm Kench, it's probably enough to keep Aneels alive for a very, very long time. Also, both of Origin's wins came with Peke on Anivia. These games are going 40 minutes plus. Anivia and Peke can get away with these slow laning phases, and then when the chaos button hits post 30 minutes and fights are in the jungle, he's been able to crush and control.
One thing that's weird though is Origin do not have a true tank here, though. Amazing on Elise, not the tankiest of junglers, even if she does go Cinder Hulk here. But with the breaking through that front line, Flash Wolves can do it, I would say, fairly easily.
Yeah, I would agree with that, especially a late-game Caitlyn against a bunch of squishies. Yeah. It's
a field day.
Perfect. What'd they go with in Aurelia, though? It's something that Stake has played in the past. It just feels so weird in the context of this world.
It's too clunky. It gets nullified by too many of the abilities on Origin's side.
Look at him. Like, there's so many things that can stun him, and he's not a true tank if he jumps in. It looks like I don't see them changing in last minute, though.
Nope. Locked in. So, more importantly, just the Black Shield negates the stun.
Wow.
If Aurelia can't stun the target she's sticking on, and then Wild Growth kind of counters that, Black Shields are going for a completely different approach in these mid-game fights where they just want to overrun you. Like, you're looking at one threat, trying to peel weld another threat, and they just pile in. But if the initial opening engage doesn't work, you're done for.
Something to watch for then. You know, they had some initial engage in their previous red side game with Malphite top coming in for the Flash Rules, but here they're going to try to go forward once again. Caitlyn, though, still in the back line, could put out some good damage from NL, but Origin, with a bunch of ranged champions, a bunch of mages.
And again, another game where Origin, if they successfully lane swap, they nullify a lot of the advantages that potentially Flash Rules have in terms of lane matchups and in teamfights. Like, Aurelia in a lane swap is ludicrously bad. Aurelia out of the lane swap coming into mid-game teamfights just sucks against this lineup. So, by all means, Flash Rules want normal standard lanes.
Stake needs to hit Trinity Force very early on in the game, and then Mercury Treads very early on as well, and then does not let Origin scale up. Otherwise, he's this hybrid damage dealer that doesn't fit against all the CC that Origin is bringing, even though, yes, Aurelia does have some of the highest tenacity in the game thanks to the passive, but like, you're just going to die.
Well, we'll see what happens then, and if you think he's going to survive and make the team fights work anyway, you can say Flash will win this one by tweeting hashtag FWWin. But if Origin will close out the series in Game 4 and move on to the top 4, it's hashtag OGWin.
And finally, both supports learning that this matchup is incredibly passive in the early game, and are finally both bringing Exhaust to the table. If you're getting games that are not bloody at all, you want Exhaust, because the late game value from that summoner spell compared to Ignite is just, it is a whole world different.
Interestingly enough, I would say the exhaust value is higher for Mithy in this matchup because he can exhaust Aurelia when he engages, but Ornn doesn't have a true exhaust target. Maybe if he's like... that's pretty much it, right? He lands his hook, flies into the middle of the team, and throws an exhaust and blocks down. I'm still a little flabbergasted by the Aurelia pick. I don't think it fits. Like, it needs to snowball really, really hard, which hasn't been Flash Rules' strength.
Stake. The mind, it will land, and the chompers will go in, so Stake will flash.
But if it's chompers,
level one.
Yep. The nails picks up some optimal level one skill. Now, minigun is only 30% attack speed at rank one, and you will hit level two before you reach the turret. So in terms of pushing in a lane swap, Neil shouldn't be held down too.
Yeah, lane swap even more valuable right now for Origin. Stake kind of avoids playing with no flash in that sense, though. If it is a lane swap, that is the one good thing for Flash Rules here. Because going into an Elise Lulu matchup there with no flash, you will get dove level 3. Minions have spawned. But this kind of solidifies the lane swap here for Origin. They could actually give level 2 experience on Krugs here to Mithy. And let Amazing Soul take a camp.
So Neil's recalling.
I think he's buffering the recall. See if somebody shows.
Yeah. It'll be a very peculiar recall, but then he walks through a ward, so lane's completely given away.
He saw it fade, though, so they know that they know.
Well, I feel like this happens a lot.
They saw him put it down, too.
This happens a lot where someone walks over a ward that dies, and then because they weren't looking at their screen, they didn't see it. The fact that they didn't ping, maybe, but it honestly doesn't matter in the context of this game.
Just to annoy a lot of people out there, suboptimal crush right there.
Yeah, he doesn't sit in the brush while attacking his Caitlyn.
And he doesn't use the AoE twice on a small one. If you have a double play Q AoE, man, why don't spread that out? Spread the love. Spread the damage.
Alright, so already misplays from Flash Wolves.
Game losing
this. A worrying trend for them coming into game 4 here. They need to win this one to stay alive.
Sword Art.
Oh, cute play steals one bit of the red buff to get level 2.
And then nearly kills himself.
Put Spec and Flash.
But a 4-man die.
Spec and Flash, QE, and yet to kill him.
Stake's already low, though. He has a guaranteed stun as Aurelia here. Maple doesn't care about how much damage he's taking in the trade. He's trying to make Spec walk up to him.
He was successful.
There's the Flash play into Exhaust. Karsa.
Dead.
Flash knockup. Pekka turns into Egg, Maple survives it, easy first blood, and it goes to... Maple.
total choice and freedom on who they give that to. Stake flies in for the assist goal at the end of the day. That's the second time Flashwolves has done a very early rotation mid lane for that gank. Peke was not respecting it. Really great bait by Maple, I would have to say. Peke completely bought it, and it cost him his life.
You gotta compare what happened to the side lanes, though, because Flashwolves spent all of their spare resources on the mid lane gank. Top lane turret is going to die here.
Peck is like,
not
gank?
Turret, not
I never,
getting hit at all.
I never died. I'm back in the lane 10 seconds later. I don't know what happened.
Where did all this gold come from for my lane opponent, though?
Yeah.
That's strange.
Okay. Neil shares gold. So as... Oh, he didn't block the minions well enough, and Neil's
gonna get them all.
Loses 10 seconds on his recall. Peck,
yeah, he's okay
in this matchup with DP. Can recoup a lot of his losses. Bot lane will go down after all.
Maple's running cleanse. I don't think it's that great running cleanse in this matchup, because Expecta can get the frost on you anyways. Post level 6 again. Teleport could help here.
I think he's really right about Cocoon, Binding, and AVQ. There's so many types of stuns that can land.
Nah, probably rather.
Yeah, it's not a pick for the matchup.
In an isolated lane matchup, perhaps it's not the best, but later in the game, cleanse does actually bring a lot of value. Especially if Maple goes for a similar build where he wants to get Abyssal up front, which he ran into double AP earlier today with an AP jungler. Actually makes more sense if he goes for that build again.
What about that Karsa has one CS up until now? He hit level 2 on Rek'Sai.
Just double the CS.
Whoa! At 4 minutes.
Falling. More levels than he has CS.
So
right now.
Look at most supports are like that. Look at Morgana.
First jungler at Worlds to achieve that feat. Congratulations.
You spawn at level 1 with 0 CS. Congratulations, everyone did that.
Fair enough, Freak.
Sorry.
Pedantic.
I know. I
love that word.
It describes me so well. Talk about a Nivea ulti mechanic like it matters.
Good last thing here by Xpeket.
Yeah.
Using the AoE stun. Rank 1 though, so Xpeket is one of the players that likes taking wall at rank 4 on Anivia. Generally, Anivia players don't opt for that because it is just too mana inefficient to even use that, weave that into a spell rotation. It's only useful if you can combine and gank and you kind of go for an all-in style approach. Amazing! Not looking to gank here.
I've also seen Peke successfully dodge some ganks with it. I actually like it more when he holds his skill point at level 4 until he's about to go aggressive or until the gank comes, but he skilled up the wall really early here.
Big push under his turret. We're going to see how much of that Soaz can actually deny here. Soaz 25 to Stakes 12 so far. Despite Flashwolves having First Blood, Origin is actually ahead in gold right now.
It's amazing farm. He's been power farming the jungle this whole time.
Yeah, he doesn't even care if he's spotted. He walks straight through mid lane and says, well, farm alarm, I'm getting level 6 here for my least power spike. You know, strongest spiderlings.
One more spiderling.
But again, also more farm efficient in terms of Avarice. It's a small difference right here, but because it's very accelerated lane swap happened, you have both of these AD carries in awkward itemization positions. Avarice plays versus second Doran's.
Yeah, I didn't feel like it mattered that much when Karsa was helping to get the gank and was staying low on CS because of that, but now he spent a lot of time going in to get deep wards while not actually farming Amazing's jungler, so the gap between these two junglers is only widening.
And the efficiency of that gank just goes down if the mid laner runs teleport. That actually used to be a very successful play in lane cells because it would tilt the matchup so far in favor of one guy, but you saw Xpeket, his egg drop basis, teleports back into lane, and he's continuously playing aggressive on Maple, so he's playing as if nothing really happened.
Maple with cleanse, not the ignite or an exhaust or anything super aggressive in the matchup, so looks like he's not able to really punish Peke. Oh! What?
What?
Whoa, trying to make the play, but flashes into a stun, and Peke doesn't even care that just happened.
Good reaction from Peke to proc that stun, though, because he was likely aiming for max range on Maple or even CS.
Yeah, I think that was set up for the
that
CS.
That was...
But he proc'd it, you know?
That was a ridiculous series of events, because also, he stunned him so quick, Maple didn't have time to draw turn aggro when he flashed in. So, he didn't even get, like, the proper turnaround. Still, flashed down on Maple as he was trying to get super aggressive for a play.
Yeah, Maple was trying to use the level advantage that he left level 6 against level 5 to just blow up Xpeket with no egg, which you can do, because he's spinning on low health. But look at Xpeket's change in build path, too. He goes for an early chalice because he knows he can actually just get exploded in this matchup. He may go for an Athena's build here. A little quicker, just in terms of map influence from Anivia.
Very true.
Just playing the farm game as far away as possible. Peke's summoners are back up now, so full power in terms of retreating and getting back to lane.
Neil's actually looking to set up a bit of a freeze in the bot lane. You up on them as they do onto you.
Right now it's plus 6. Soaz actually equal to stake right now. So, you know, as much as we had a lane swap game, we got the lanes back to normal pretty quickly. The top laners are only, you know, 6 CS behind the AD carry. Now a flash play onto Peke. Oh my god, he's immediately an egg. And once again, kill goes to NL this time.
Spread the love between them. Peke doesn't actually have time to use a summoner spell. So Flashful setting up a pretty heavy camp towards that mid lane. That was even the small window that Neil's had freezing that wave, even though now the freeze is broken. It's immediately punished by Flashful with that roam mid.
That was greedy. I just watched that play. Sword Art was on a ward for over 5 seconds before he passed it into the mid lane for that flash play. That was ultimate greed by Xpeke. He could have easily made it out. All he had to do was drop the CS.
Stop farming.
Let's take the rest of Orton, though. Wanted to take as much as they can, making Karsa jump over the wall to his own red buff, but really not a lot gained here. Orton still doing better on farm as we expect, but they are dropping a lot of kills now in this game.
Got the CS, though.
Yep.
Back in lane. Quick teleport from Peke, trying to keep up in experience. The game itself, despite the two deaths, has pretty much even both now, although a large wave is hitting NL on the bottom side as well as the top side, so this is actually a decent lead for Flashful.
It's a weird, really efficient build if you calculate in that later on in teamfights, Xpeke dying will not generate any gold. It'll be like 0-3. It does give him more experience towards Flashful's other team.
Well, keep in mind, if you get CS, you actually roll back the death streak anyway.
It requires a lot of CS for that too.
Every 100 CS counts for one death. And it's not like a quick thing as when you hit 100 all the way, it's just gradual over time.
Yeah, linear.
Now we're going to see Origin group up towards his bot side, and they do have the BF sword on Jinx. Once again, it's an item that he has over NL here.
Something we haven't talked about, though, if Xpeke can lock Maple into this lane, the remaining members of OG form an incredibly strong and potent siege squad. Especially since Maple doesn't have to teleport to join. If you get Lulu combined with Morgana there and amazing on the Elise, around Niels as a squad there, you can just throw out these skill shots. One connects, facilitates the other one, and you can zone people of power, so that may be something Origin will look for later.
I think it's one of the main ways Origin has a chance of winning this game, specifically with the Anivia wall as well. Setting up sieges of turrets, walling off one side, and then going strong for it. Sword Art.
No flash this time.
Yeah, it doesn't have the flash to continue that gank. Even so, it would have been into a black shield, which is a really difficult gank to make work.
And this is why the Morgana pick actually works, because Aurelia wants to dive in, even use a minion to launch herself forward, but then if you have a Black Shield on Neil, so you can just kite her.
Becca with a good setup here. He's gonna, I think, lose it eventually because the minions are doing some damage. So he's gotta, there you go, has to burst that one.
Every single CS. Nice job by Becca.
That's incredibly hard, by the way. Lost the Olivia.
He must be Diamond.
It's like this guy's Diamond or something.
Neils and Mythi back into the duel lane up against NL and Sword Art. 80 carries, honestly, roughly splitting it exactly. Soaz and Snake doing the exact same as well for the top lane.
And Amazing actually doing a really good job shadowing this lane here in the bot lane. Classic Cthulhu, but...
But there's too much of the team around. Amazing's gotta run away. Black Shield broken, hook! Woo. Nearly lands.
Look at Peke, he can now push mid lane, even put a bit, tiny wall down there. Put some pressure. He's afraid to kill that tunnel.
I think for a pretty good reason.
He just wants to bait him into coming in them walls. That's he does that every time. He's like, you want to come this way? Sure, go ahead. Wall. Gets a couple extra hits here.
Fortunately, maybe not exactly the best turret killer, so not a ton gain. But Origin, get the ward control back over this bottom jungle. A couple wards down from Mythi, and the Scuttler picked up as well.
So aside from the two ganks that Flashful successfully pulled off on Origin in the early game, this is the slow game. This is Soaz getting his Rod of Ages in the top lane. It's Stake not rushing to a Trinity Force. The AD carry slowly working up to their item breakpoints, and no one even going for an early dragon. It is the slow, measured approach that we've seen in most of these matches.
This time, Amazing has been really better around the ball to really identify the weakness, which was the bot lane. He's just constantly been hovering around the bot lane. Xpeke sped up now for a wall combo. Can't quite connect. And Soaz is fine in the top lane, so the only lane that could really get ganked there really was the bot lane. So Amazing constantly hovering around that, just getting Neils comfortably into a position where he can start carrying the game later on. I think Origin is fine with this approach.
And I think if this game does stretch really into the 40-minute mark without a large discrepancy, the Anivia-Lulu combo in particular to speed up the Anivia in order to get a wall, I think can be easily game-winning for Origin. It's their big edge in this matchup because they can get the team fights split up, and that allows Niels to then pretty much kill whoever he wants because they can separate the tanks from the damage dealers. And even though they're all squishy, it won't matter because it'll give them time to take down the tanks if they can execute it properly.
I think Origin, that was actually the combo they ran initially because it turns Wall from just a defensive peeling tool into actually an offensive weapon, because if you want to usually move up with Anivia to get in wall range, you just expose yourself. It takes too long to get in that position. Spenky now again teleporting back to lane with like 75% mana. He just really doesn't want to drop any bits of experience. Already on 40% here, and that siege is not going to work. It's just like last game, Maple will just wave clear, wave after wave.
And you can see that even though Niels had that short-term freeze earlier on, the AD carries are actually back at L's way. Niels just not really out farming that one anymore, top lane matchup. So as it's take, they trade hard CC, and now
the minions though helping Soaz here. Good positioning by him.
Right back into the minion line. Couple 100 extra damage per second because of that one. The early average play pickup for Niels does help quite a bit though. He's actually earned almost 400 gold from that so far. That's actually helping keep the gold as close as it is.
And Stake is still 800 gold away from Trinity Force. But Origin is fine not forcing on that early advantage either, because Rod of Ages versus not Trinity Force Rally would be better for the Soaz.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I think it's just Origin being so confident in this late game team composition they put together, and when they get to the late game with gold even, they're fine playing this out for the next 15 minutes.
Well, and this is finally a game as well. We've had two, I'm talking about Soaz here, we've got two Darius versus Gnar matchups where Soaz can't push to win. And now two Lulu versus X matchups where Soaz is able to push. And Origin can actually play around one of their side lanes finally. Yamato Kanna talked about it on the analyst desk, and I agree with him, where there's this player to leverage in Soaz in the side lane. Getting him a good matchup, I think, is super relevant here, and you're seeing lanes and champions and turrets getting worn down from it.
I fully expect to add mana here, because then Origin can actually rotate, look for a dive in the mid lane. Clicking old mana here, but Maple, I left his tower exposed.
Well, Niels is there. He did the early rotation.
He doesn't have teleport. Had to recall at some point to get upgraded boots and everything else and check out pressures.
And now soul farming in the bot lane again though, panning my camera over. He really takes his time clearing his waves. That's how he wants to get subtle CS advantages. But you lose the map. You can do that when you have a winning top lane or there's nothing left to take, but it just loses you so much pressure. And there's only so much gold when you're freezing that you can get. It's like 20 gold for every minion, but it goes slower because you keep the wave frozen, as opposed to people taking towers, pressure, deep vision, jungle camps on the other side of the map.
Well, specifically, the dragon is up right now while trying to freeze, so it becomes a much more punishable freeze. They've already lost the mid turret during that, and it doesn't have much lifesteal from this, so much better reaction here from Origin this time around.
If Niels didn't stop to throw the chomper first, they actually would have chain looted NL. The chomper actually activated right after he clicked on the lantern. If he didn't stop for Zap, that would have been probably at least heal burn. Maybe a bit more. Small misplay by Niels, but Dragon, of course, has been on the map for a while. And with the bot lane being forced out, actually, this is actually a time that Origin could have pressed hard for this play. They choose not to. It's going to be the farm game. Krug's going over. Easily picked up by Niels. And again, if you just contrast the two players' gold incomes, despite the fact that NL has a kill, the Jinx is more gold.
And the only matchup that's really far behind is Xpec in the mid lane. As you can see on screen there, he's down 700 gold. But everybody else on Origin just excelling, because overall they're ahead of gold while their mid lane is down 700. So that's a big gold disparity in the remaining lanes. And because of the nature of the Anivia Victor matchup, if you don't die on level 6 on that all in, it doesn't matter that you down 700 gold, because all you do is literally just AFK farm those waves.
Yeah.
Whereas if you look at Soaz against Stake, you can actually use that advantage. Nice crit there.
Not far away, and nice jump to the minion. Just to look cool. Stake, though, losing a bad trade. The stun's gonna land. Peke really wants this one. Force the flash away.
Yeah, that is what's expected. A lot of tenacity being built up by Stake already. Mercury Treads, plus he is Aurelia, who naturally has more tenacity, more enemies that are near. He should have the gold for Trinity Force
it's
now.
Not quite enough. It's not for Merc Treads.
Oh, geez, you're right.
If not for Merc Treads, he'd have the item right now, but...
Well, not for Merc Treads.
He might have died. Sure. I mean, I can't complain on that one.
classic stake, staying alive.
So much effort was put in the top lane by Origin that Flash Rolls were able to bring Karsa and then over to the Dragon.
You can see across map here, push mid into rotation on top and dive on stake. Could be a play that Origin's looking for right now. Moving Neils into mid lane to hold.
He's got to hold his bot lane though, so pushed in towards him now. So has the way to fight with Snake, but Amazing's right there. Good. Oh no! Actually queued a minion to hit Cocoon, but doesn't matter, he's got Tenacity.
Yeah, also, when the Cocoon hit, that's when the stun timer starts ticking, but he's going to complete his movement from the Aurelia Q anyway, so he basically gets unstunned the instant he arrives at his target. I will say, like, it's yet another really slow game for Origin Flash Wolves, and this, while it's okay in the context of this particular matchup between these two teams, since they're both slow, the other teams in this world are watching this, SKT as well as AHQ, two teams that play a much faster game style. AHQ kind of dominated Flash Wolves every time they played each other in the LMS, and obviously they're preparing for their matchup against each other, but if it gets to the semifinals with either one of these teams, there are so many vulnerabilities that are open in the early to mid game between these teams. But as we are now, it's kind of like an arms race about who can get to late game safer.
Who can invest more and then pull it all out, you know, 20, 30 minutes later onto the game.
And what a fantastic style it is, right? The slow, methodically, not boring at all approach with the Anivia.
Kreppo reliving the glory days when he was a relevant League of Legends player.
This was the best time of League of Legends for Kreppo. He's had this huge smile on his face this whole time.
The stuns land, so there's no damage follow-up. Sorta overextends, and he's gonna go down to Neils. Jinx is happy about that one. So has also buying some time with the Summoner Teleport. And L in a bad way, taking more damage. The flash knock if the rocket hits, and Peke from downtown gets the kill. But the fight isn't done yet. Flash Wolves waiting around the wing.
Oh, CC chain.
But Karsa wants it. Black Shield is used on Peke. 3, 2, 1. He's stunnable. Neils goes down because the Black Shield went somewhere else. Maple forced the Flash to run. More kills coming through. Stake is here for the cleanup. At least a little bit by Karsa. Will be another casualty. And it's 4-2 for Origin.
Yeah, really bold aggression right there. After Flash Wolves lost two members early on in the fight, they're like, you know what, 3v5, we can get something back. We got some powerful people up. But it really just cost them more because now Origin gets to continue this push on to the turret and take a pretty big edge 20 minutes into the game.
First real lead they've had now in game 4. 3,000 gold up for Origin. And if they close this one out, they make top 4 at Worlds.
Yeah, first real fight we've seen, too, as the teleports activate, basically, as Victor's roaming down.
Yeah, now look at this player. Sword Art goes in, but he overextends. He drops almost immediately, and the CC chain just overall, it's just so strong, and especially in these longer, extended fights from Origin, finding Cocoon just comes up many times during the fight, whereas kind of Flash Wolves, they only have one figure. They go in, blow it up, and then if that works, you kill him. If it doesn't, you're probably going to get kited.
Yeah.
Flash Wolves, one thing they're very good at is getting something after dying, though, and NL's already up in this top lane. He's gonna stay around, feel safe enough. Turret goes down. Blinding still hits, but there's no follow-up.
Even so, the Avarice Blade is still ticking for Neils. This is a rather incredible Avarice Blade, I would have to say. Plus 599 gold for Neils already in this. You can see the fight that we just saw as well. How much work Maple nearly did right there. 7,400 damage just in that one team fight. Apparently that statistic is incorrect, so I apologize to the viewers. Never mind.
Me?
I think he did a lot of damage, though.
I would almost wager he did.
Go ahead, Sam.
Tons of damage.
But it wasn't. It wasn't.
Yeah. We were together here.
Say it.
Steal my pun. We work together here. It's not a pun. What do you... Not everything is a joke is a pun, Kreppo. How have you not learned this so far? Flash Wolves trying to claw back in. 4-4 in kills. They're down a turret. They've got the first dragon. Next one comes up at 145. But Origin right now are starting to really take control now. Amazing is going very squishy, by the way. You play the two Rylan's Crystal Scepter. There is truly no tank on this team.
Yeah. And around 25 minutes is when these pushing side lanes that Origin have in terms of blue actually start opening up another win condition for them, which is the Baron. They can use the side lane pressure to draw people away, then get deep vision into jungle, and then really use their lineup to punish Flash Wolves. Because Origin lineups is the strongest when Flash Wolves have to face check into the dark, into a binding, into a cocoon, into zap and trap, into wild growth. There's so many tools, and they can even wall you in. If you, at any given point, lose complete vision on a Baron, you'll likely lose the game at that point.
Yeah. I am wondering, though, Stake is kind of in this mid-game power spike that he needs to be able to execute on. And when it gets to the late game, I think he's going to completely lose the power. But with a Spectre's Cal, Mercury Treads, and an Aegis, it's hitting an immense amount of magic because it's 13 minutes in. He will be at about 140 when he goes into these fights, which is actually a little lower than I was expecting, but still decently high, and have the large amount of tenacity coming in here. He's going to need to make it work now, otherwise I think Flash Wolves loses the game.
With this build, though, such an incredibly greedy build. He gets the Talisman, the Nomad's Medallion. He gets the Forbidden Idols. Like, okay, I can upgrade, but I like this whole, you know, gold generation thing going on, and I just want some more CDR. Double Forbidden Idol. He's sitting right now on 1.4k HP. He can get bossed in a single. If he accidentally looks the wrong way at Maple, Maple can QR him and just finish him off.
That's ridiculous.
But look at this. Flash Wolves have control over the Dragon area. They've got the wards down first. They've got the Scuttler as well. You can't remove that. You gotta wait it out. Origin pressure mid has a reaction to this. And then right back they go down towards the Dragon area.
Yeah, this is gonna be a big Dragon right here. Obviously, there's one Dragon for Flash Wolves already, but they're just not in a position to contest this one. And they're kind of losing out on this mid-game power spike. I think Origin's well on the way to outscaling.
Yeah, look at the zone control. Traps can close off an exit. Wall closes off the other one. So incredibly good understanding of their composition. If Flash Wolves can close the gap, they can do a lot of damage. But you can close off exit number one, close off exit number two. And if Flash Wolves don't even find door number three, they can't even enter the fight.
They did lose a little bit of farm in the bottom lane there. You can see the AD carry behind 30 here as there was a push from the Flash Wolves minions that just got absorbed by the turret. Minor loss there, not the worst thing in the world.
Stake.
Do what he can. Itemizing mostly magic assist. He thinks he can just stun the enemy AD carry, otherwise just surviving mages.
Something that does happen though to a lot of pro players is that they forget about the mid laner summoner spells. And at one point this fight can turn if they actually land CC on Maple, commit to him, and then get surprised by the cleanse. Actually happens very often, more often than you would think so.
Yep.
If Maple eats up CC, sidestep to follow up, he can turn on these fights, but oops, that's not gonna happen.
Look at all this damage, a two-man play. Soaz pulls the black shield, and this team is ready to go to war. A knockup on Amithi's Stake is in range. Now how much damage can he deal? Neil's off in the side, but here comes Maple. Morgana's already dead. The flash engage. Stake has two. He is on the chase, slows down Soaz, getting hit up by Neil's, but doesn't have enough damage yet as a two-item jinx.
Yeah, I mean, the incredibly greedy build of Mithy is punished right there. He died right before his ultimate was going to proc for the stun, and it's a big swing in this fight. Maple also trying to chase down Soaz.
And more importantly, look at Xpeke. He was not part of that fight. He was in the bot lane base, walked to top, then he teleported. He's like, you know what? You guys are losing. I'm not going to join this fight.
Well, ooh, oh, damage. Now Karsa is the one who's greedy. Neils gets one back. Soaz gets out.
Such a nice play there by Soaz and Neils. Really just saving each other and coming up on top. No way should Origin have been able to pick up a kill off the back of that fight, but they do.
I'll ask you the question though. Yes, Xpeke had teleport, but it looks like they weren't planning a clear fight. They didn't know where Xpeke, when he should teleport. Lack of communication there because they were sieging format so aggressively. And they got surprised by the flank from Karsa. We actually only just got a support, so overall that should have still been a winnable fight by Origin, but TP was so late. Watch that again. Karsa in the bottom left of your screen is flanking. Maple's running to the mid lane right now.
Yeah, this is where Xpeke would need to start channeling his teleport right now so that the chase would stop for Flash Wolves, but they stay in there. Then he channels his teleport in a ward behind the fight and realizes he should cancel it. Just a bad teleport choice from Xpeke right there. Origin ends up burning their summoner spells, and if not for the flame choppers there, would have suffered more casualties. The CC chain continues.
Xpeke gets hooked!
Oh, that was bad for him. Gets away just in time.
Oh.
Nearly out of health. Shields keep him away. Of course, he has the egg either way, but still, that is a low health Anivia who can't be in this fight. No teleport either.
NL did take a fair bit of damage in that as well, though, so that's going to make it hard for Flash Wolves to push down this. Plus, we have this threatening Jinx coming at them with Lulu. This is such a breaker in this game. That's why I still think Orton has a big lead.
It's more than just the 2,000 gold. We got some great champions. They're hard to track down, too. Three Mercury treads on the lineup. They're hard to pick up.
And also, later on, Mithy's obviously now finished up Talisman of Ascension. So he's making get his team out of there. But later on, he can also just get a Mikhail's. That's another removal for Niels to keep him alive. That means Niels can probably go for a quadruple attack damage item build and then just rely on the Mikhail's combined with the Black Shield to keep him out of harm's way. Because there's only two spells he needs to be careful about. That is the Aurelia Stun and a potential hook from Sword Art. Both are incredibly easy to use Mikhail's upon.
Yeah. He needs to get that as soon as possible.
Another thing I like, actually, is this is the third Victor game Maple has played and the third Anivia game Peke has played. But they've done unique builds in all three matchups. Like, yes, Maple did go for the Abyssal Scepter, but now it looks like he's going for Death Gap as a second item instead of the Lich Bane, because he knows he doesn't have the Ghost this time to walk around and get Lich Bane procs. And Peke did the Athene's build because of the early defensive necessity in this matchup, and then quickly transitions to the Liandry's. I love the adaptation from this guy.
Yeah, Maple couldn't win fights with this repetitive damage build, so he's more going for Shotgun Victor, walks in, takes the CC, cleans out Flash QER, and hopefully blows somebody up in the process.
And of course, by contrast, Peke is all about the burn damage. He's got no magic hit, and he's got no big AP burst. Sora is also an interesting build, gets Ardent Sensor, so really building around this Jinx, as long as you shield her, it's gonna have bonus attack speed and magic damage on hit. It can really take games over.
Why not? I mean, Niels, hang on, Sora's going in a Sword Art here. He should be able to get buffed here.
Auto attack doesn't even need to ult. It gets the kill picked up. Soaz, tanky enough. Niels does not get knocked up. A great cocoon by Amazing buys a lot of time. And Origin are not done. Karsa goes down. Kill lead for Origin.
Tanky was up there.
Yeah, teleport had to be canceled, but it didn't matter because this Niels Soaz combination is so powerful. They don't even need Peke, and he's actually their trump card in later game teamfights in the jungle. This is Origin looking like they're going to be moving on to semifinals if they continue to play smart.
Yeah, and I just love Niels' playstyle and attitude. Coming in as a rookie this young, going from challenge and only like unproven player, he just doesn't care. Nothing phases the guy. They build an entire composition around him, and look at the damage he's doing right now to Sig.
They get the root on Sig. He can't stun anybody. There's a shutdown. More kills coming through. Mithy flashes away from Maple, and Victor just isn't doing any damage here. None that matters. Origin walk away with another kill to their name.
And it goes to show the danger that Flash Wolves have put themselves under. No true tank to face check. They were already down a member before that fight. Maple would have to expose himself there, and it's in the jungle, so they're already having to worry about the Anivia. Really, the cards are in Origin's hand. There's so many ways they can outplay Flash Wolves right here.
Flash Wolves still, the Master's getting something back. Mid lane outer goes down, despite Anivia's best efforts. The game is within 4,000 here. Dragon's Tide. Righteous Glory, I believe, coming in next for Mithy after the Talisman of Ascension.
That means he sold.
It also builds into Aegis if he wants a Banner of Command.
And he sold a Forbidden Idol.
Yeah, he did. He sold a second Forbidden Idol.
It's like, we don't need defense. Offense.
Yeah, it is like, the best defense.
I feel like the Mikhail's would have been good, especially with how much they're empowering Niels. But at the same time, it's still a very small amount of CC, and Niels has the confidence to just outplay.
At the same time, though, it does mean that the only use for Mikhail's is if Black Shield can't prevent the stun from Aurelia and the hook from Fish. It's literally the only case where it's necessary, so it's almost too safe in that regard, because Niels, he's actually really good at positioning and staying on harm's way, though. And worst case, if he gets hit, Lulu will help him anyways.
Right. He's got ways to dodge everything, so looking for that kind of a build here. So as the scaling build has paid off, that Rod of Ages doing just fine for him.
You didn't know we were running a kiss scan this
time. Just has to happen.
Yeah.
Has to happen, Crepo. I actually wasn't watching the pimp cam, so I completely missed it.
I did too.
Some fine gentlemen in the crowd. I saw you guys, don't worry. I'm paying attention to you, London.
Hey.
You're saying as if we aren't. No one left in my underground joke though, so now I'm kind of salty about it.
It's okay.
Origin, looking for the death crush. Revealed by the trinket though, nothing picked up. Oh! That's a hook on a Soaz, that's a flash away, but Karsa does not get the knock up thanks to Wild Growth. There's no chain for the getaway.
Both teams with an interesting exchange there. If they don't fight, we can actually explain it. Usually when you see a lantern come out, you want to try to mad life the skill shots to the position where people are lanterning to, but Maple actually didn't decide to click that lantern, so it was a bit of a bait on both ends there.
I do also think that Origin is playing a little bit sloppy. They keep using Peke as their split pusher, even though he doesn't have his teleport. Origin's so strong and confident right now with the Soaz Neos combination in the mid lane that they're getting away with it, but they are opening themselves up to a clean engage from Flash Wolves if Flash Wolves decides to go for a 5v4.
I mean, if you play a Froggen champion, you gotta keep farming.
345 CS, 33 minutes in.
There we go.
How about that?
But the thing is, Snake is actually out-farming Soaz here in terms of expectations of a matchup. Snake is doing quite well, 3 completed items plus the Merc Treads. This is a durable Aurelia who can wreak havoc on the back line. So if she can get in alongside some other Bash buddies, there is some real threat here.
One thing we haven't taken into account is you don't need hard CC against the Jinx. You can keep her moving when she's not orb walking, trying to auto-attack at the same time. You're effectively CCing her damage. And Origin's composition relies on that damage to win fights, so when Neos is under pressure, under threat, the damage drops significantly in these fights, and that could be a potential comeback for the Flash Wolves.
Meanwhile, Amazing just now going into his first real tank item. After the Rylas has the Aegis of the Legion in, we'll see if he goes for Locket or Banner of Command afterwards, but finally a Magic Resist Aura in for this team. So far, Origin have managed to dodge most fights they didn't care about. And it will be double Aegis, by the way, here for Origin. So I expect Locket from Amazing, Banner from Biffy.
That would be the logical choice for these guys. So Origin not. Now they have Soaz down in the bottom lane. Which kind of limits their mobility within the mid lane side. So Flash Wolves will be able to draw this around a little bit longer.
Remember how Origin last game or two games ago tried to go in, realized if we kite, we actually more prone to win these games. Flash Wolves could take a similar approach once NL his four items, because he's going for the best damage build on Caitlyn. Getting IH PD now, if you finish up potentially Lost Whisper also, getting like a Band-Aid, Band Scepter, just some lifesteal. He could actually kite well in these fights, and if Neil Scott connect and chase in these fights due to the zone control, a potential stake engage has on them, then NL can actually shred through the front line.
It's weird because even though there's no like true health tanks, Blade of the Rune King is actually still more DPS than Bloodthirster. And it's cheaper as well. He's behind significantly in gold under Neils, who is stacking up an Average Blade and has 4 kills.
But he may just go straight to Lost Shortcuts.
And it's a possibility as well that even as a 4th item, still taking more shortcuts and catching up sooner.
Snake abandoning the split push. He's actually roaming down to the mid lane, so he set up a slow push at least. The Flash Wolves in about 2 minutes can use that to their advantage. Xpeke realizes it isn't base with the home guard, so Origin know how the split push game works, and they try to stop it in the setup phase.
Snake looks for the flank. Neos feels confident with the black shield on, and chucks Snake out.
We're really seeing the vulnerabilities of Snake's Aurelia right here. It's getting towards late game. He can't even engage on the target he wants to reach. Neos is too fast for Snake to even get in range for a Blade Surge. Like, unless they get some ideal flank, they're already looking to get 5v4s, and they're not even accounting for the peel of the Anivia, and they're still incapable of getting these fights.
And zone control coming out of mid lane, even without the Anivia, that split push. Now a split push is set up in the bot lane, so the exact same story that we were telling about the Flash Wolves now holds true for Origin, and look at that crit!
Puts the rock in! Oh no! No one blocks it out, and NL is gone!
Healed, burned as well there, so this is a powerful push for Origin because finally, Peke has arrived.
And here they go into the mid lane. AD carry missing is a big deal. Anivia wall blocks off the moves, the turret's down.
Signature Anivia push, ulti on the left side, wall on the right side, 45 in it drops.
And now do they risk going for Baron right now? Farsa does have the ulti, pops it to get right up towards that jungle. Does have flash, does have smite. There are no wards inside the pit right now for Flash, but they can go in.
Well, it's a death cap Victor, but he's really far away, and this Baron goes down so fast. They need a way to stop the steal attempt, though.
Chompa's on one side, Karza can still get in.
Yeah, this is buying a little bit of time. He can go in for steal.
Doesn't quite land a good lantern out, but a clutch smite from Amazing. Another stun lands, Zap goes in, no kills.
It's a bold move, though, to go for a Baron. Relatively unnecessary.
But with that,
they do snowball the game, so... Yeah.
Origin is poised to move on to the semifinals. Already up 2-0. Baron in hand. Superior team composition for the late game. And a massive power spike for Neils, who has just completed his last Whisper.
That is a very big jinx. Soaz gets to solo hold the mid lane with no competition.
Dragon 3 and easy pickup afterwards.
Man, this is what we talked about earlier in Champs Light 2. A lot of the issues with this Jinx pick versus Kaylin got solved. You know, Kaylin trades first, doesn't matter, because Jinx is sped up and the auto attacks trade evenly.
Uh-oh, Karsa taking the wrong tunnel, gets off of the wrong exit. There's the last grid to take him out. Nails is huge.
He gets Pixie and Black Shield and gets sped up. He's a one-man army, and there's nobody can trade against him, because you have to trade almost 2v1 to win those trades, and then the remaining Origin members just follow suit and just throw out CC spells.
Well, when it all comes down to it, Origin put their faith in the rookie AD carry, and Niels trying to carry them into the World Championship semifinal. 6-1 and 3, the seed's still happening. There goes the second inhibitor turret.
And Flash Wolves cannot repel this push, especially with Karsa down before the fight. And the thing is, they still have half of their Baron left, so they can use the empowered recalls, run straight to the next lane, and try and work on inhibitor number 3.
Exactly where they go. Red buff on Niels. In case the movement speed wasn't enough, how about a slow on those rockets as well? Niels can crush this game.
And then, yeah, expect as a Nivea right now, only on 3 items. Just the utility it brings to the siege, though, if you do get in that position, you shut off exit number 1 on the right side, you completely wall that off. If you want to get to the tower to defend it, you gotta go through the Nivea ulti. You're slowed, and then it's incredibly easy target practice for Mithy and Amazing with Binding Cocoon, so there's almost no counterplay. Unless you're flanking this line of Maple, though, gets predicted.
Whoa, big burst of damage, but it's not enough to win the team fight outright. Maybe there's gonna be some follow-up. Soaz teleports in to be a bit more of a support there. A big three-man stun. They're gonna go back in. Origin don't find the attacks yet, though. Niels gets whimsy. Yeah. Attack.
So that was actually super greedy Soaz right there. He was killing Gromp, trying to get enough money to recall and buy a death cap and then join the siege, but the team got initiated on, so he had to burn his teleport from Gromp. And now Origin may be a little bit repelled on this push.
Look at the base, so they can take their time here. They're just waiting for the minions to pile in, but this was Flash was finally adapting. It's the same way like we talked about Splinkush. If you let it happen, it's too late. Heals Black Shield.
And he's just gonna be fine with it. Doesn't really even care about the turret aggro. Another turret goes down. 8 in the game for Origin here.
You gotta flank this Origin lineup. You can't defend from the front. It's impossible to really do that.
Baron times out, but look at that. You can't go from the front, and an Nivea wall blocks off half the passage. Stake goes in. Sword Art low on health, and here comes the fight. Karsa killed off already. Sword Art should be next. Black Shield was down. They buy a bit of time. Another couple of kills come through, and Stake has nowhere to go. A few more shots will do it.
Oh.
Boom! The kills come in, and this could be the semifinals for Origin. There's only one man left alive. This will surely be the base, and Europe has a semifinalist in the World Championship. As Origin with 3-1.
40 minutes and 32 seconds in, and that one failed quick. But honestly, Origin, their most controlled and strong game yet. They systematically wore down the Flash Wolves as the series progressed, using the Jinx Lulu against Flash Wolves expertly. And honestly, Peke, 3 Anivia games of all champions to give them their 3 wins here in the quarterfinal.
A fantastic champion.
Yep.
The fucking mechanics and turning up abilities, blasting in a turret. I mean, a beautiful game. Peke proving he still has it. The Season 1 World Champion coming back to the world stage here many times, now on his own team.